we have these crossroads. And you know, either way you choose, your life is going to be different.
The universe doesn't exist, but God thinks it does.
We have to stop consuming our culture. We have to create culture.
Stupidity has a definite evolutionary function. I am all for abolishing stupidity, but before it goes, we should pay tribute to it.
Hello and welcome to the Nonsense Bazaar. We're your hosts. I'm Sequoia Kennedy.
And I'm Willow Truman.
Willow, we can't let the alien menace win.
It's already winning.
I know.
It's already won. It's not winning yet. I won't concede.
No.
But it's really throttled us hard.
It's throttled us hard.
I'm not even kidding. Like, if you think this is an act, it's not.
It's not. We lost like 5 hours of recording.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Might be for the better, though.
Maybe. We lost episodes 1 and 2 of this series. So we're doing it again. Can't give in.
Yeah. Getting in the time machine. Going back.
Going back.
We're going to do it over. Do it better.
It's going to be fine.
Yes.
Okay. We haven't done a big old series in a while. And it was time weeks ago. But it's about time again.
It's goddamn time.
It's goddamn time. All right, we've talked about this greasy bastard before, but now we're going to give him the full treatment. And I'm talking about the shady as all living fuck parapsychologist Andrija Puharich, whom you'll remember from our episode on The Nine. And we'll be covering some of the same ground on this series, but mostly I'm going to direct y'all to go back and listen to that one when the time comes. That was about, you know, the CIA channeling entities that said they were from, that they were the ancient Egyptian gods and all that shit. You go back and listen to it.
Yeah.
One of the primary characters in that saga, perhaps the primary character, was the parapsychologist Andrija Puharich. Now, here's the thing. I need to get out my soapbox real quick. This thing's getting rickety.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of people have some very positive feelings towards Andrija Puharich. Why? Well, he was, for sure, a pioneering parapsychologist.
Right, which is not to be understated.
It's not. He's a very smart motherfucker. His book, Beyond Telepathy, is fantastic. He was a genius, and in fields that are usually played for laughs, getting a genius on your side is a big get.
But also kind of a madman. I mean, not kind of.
Oh, no, he was a greasy fucking bastard.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he's also, on the flip side of that, he's also portrayed as a primary villain in, like, the conspiracy theory worldview, specifically like mind control conspiracy theories, right? Because he has connections to CIA, Army intelligence, psychotronic mind control, the plot to enslave the minds of all the world under the New Age religion and get Jesus out of our schools. Yeah. That last bit's a little bit of sarcasm there, a little bit of hyperbole, but I do kind of think that perspective is closer to the truth while still falling short. My position is, and has been, that many people fall for the fallacy of thinking that intelligent equals morally good.
Oh, God, no.
No, I don't believe that for a second. Like, it's almost like the fallacy of, like, reason equals good, right? Which is, like, strikes me as a, you know, consequence of, like, the rational materialist worldview and shit. We've talked about many completely amoral scientists on the show.
Yeah. Well, I feel like scientists are really good at, you know, justifying their whatever it is they seek to do. They're like, you know what, but I have a good reason,
right?
For science, though.
Yeah, it's the ambition and dedication to the research itself. Like,
right,
specialization creates tunnel vision, and human lives are short and time goes by very, very fast, and it's easy for people to turn a blind eye to the shadows on the periphery as long as the work continues.
It's true.
Yeah.
Because there's, like, a lot out there. But, yeah, you're right about tunnel vision, especially scientists.
Yeah.
Especially people like Andrija Puharich.
Yeah.
You know, they get sort of on this one track.
And he may have been even a little bit more than that.
Mm-hmm.
I think he may have had some delusions of grandeur of his own through much of it.
And I'm sure that wasn't helped by his psychedelic mushroom research and other crazy-ass drugs he was taking. You know, those do have an effect on your mind.
Yeah.
It's delirious.
Specifically, like, well, we'll get to that in a little bit, but I would submit that Andrija Puharich does fall under this mad scientist umbrella.
Totally.
How much of his shenanigans were smokescreens, CIA plots, giant illusions, magical fuckery, like, maybe we'll have an opinion on at the end of this series. But this dude is squirrely. This is a hard one. This is a fucking hard series to do. But chances are, dear listener, you've probably never even heard of this man, unless you heard us talk about him before. So why should you care? What's the hook? Like, he's just some weird psychic scientist? Well, there's a lot to the hook.
Yeah.
From working at Edgewood Arsenal on chemical warfare experiments to alleged connections with the mind control programs Artichoke, Pelican, and MKULTRA, to discovering Uri Geller and running around Israel with Geller while being fucked with by a giant spaceship named Spectra, channeling the Nine with, as author Peter Lavenda puts it, what looked like a prayer meeting of the Association of Former Intelligence Officers, to hosting some of the world's best and brightest at his lab, Lab 9, where apparently he also had a bunch of psychic children that came from somewhere.
Oh yeah, duh.
To being friends with Ira Einhorn, the so-called unicorn killer who invented Earth Day. Also, he discovered the psychoactive properties of the Amanita muscaria mushroom and did a bunch of work on parapsychology. This motherfucker did a lot. It's kind of insane.
Mm.
And he was a greasy fucking bastard. So let's get into it. But before we do, let's pull a tarot card for this first portion of Puharich's life and see what we get.
Man, I was like, what is the unicorn killer? So I looked it up.
Yeah.
And I'm like, holy shit, bro.
Yeah. Yeah, that's...
He was a fugitive for like 20 years.
Yeah, dude. Emily Louise, Weird Reads with Emily, is doing a video on Ira Einhorn around about this time. Yeah. Yeah, dude. He's a piece of shit. He was friends with Andrija Puharich, too. Friends. They're buds. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Body found in a trunk.
Yeah, dude.
Lord.
Very different card from the one we got last time, but I think also appropriate. Six of Discs. Six of Pentacles.
Oh.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Yeah. I pulled that for myself today.
Oh, it keeps showing up for me.
Yeah.
It's one of those cards that's just showing up over and over again for me.
Wait, let me make sure it's the one I'm thinking. Yep, it's definitely the one I'm thinking of.
Yeah. Six of Discs. Success. Yeah. That would be...
That is so weird that I pulled that today.
Dude, this card's been plaguing me.
No, it's a good card to plague you.
I suppose.
No, it is, though.
It is. It is.
Like, it is.
Yeah.
Because that's exactly what I just said as you were shuffling the cards, and you'll cut out of the episode, but I'll reiterate right now for our listeners to get in on, you know, get in our little bullshit that we cut out. I was saying that both Ira Einhorn and Andrija Puharich have benefited from the wealth of benefactors.
Yes.
Provided them the means with which to do their crazy bullshit.
Yeah.
That is literally the Six of Pentacles.
It literally is. Yeah, straight up.
I mean, it's in the Rider-Waite-Smith deck, it's a dude who's doling out coins to two beggars.
Yeah.
It's this benefactor, this guy who he's generous with his wealth.
And I mean, as we'll see going forward in like part two with like fucking Uri and Spectra the spaceship, it's another sort of patron situation with that whole fucking weird bullshit. But yeah, Six of Discs. All right, we will talk about that at the end of the episode. It's one of those like rare tracks that just whoops ass and is not on Spotify.
Not on Spotify, you say?
Yeah.
Just like all of Joanna Newsom's stuff.
Really?
Yeah.
Why did she get...
No, no.
Did she get mad at Joe Rogan?
No, it was off there way before that. It was never on there.
No shit. Interesting.
Yeah.
And Electric Avenue.
Mm-hmm. You know, some artists, they have enough integrity to say, you know what, if I'm going to get paid pennies, no.
Well, you know, it's podcasters on Spotify don't get shit.
And I don't care.
Join our Patreon. All right. So, Andrija Puharich was born as Henry Carl Puharich on February 19th, 1918 in Chicago, Illinois. A lot of people think he's not an American. He is. He was born in Chicago. His parents were Croatian immigrants, right? Who had left their homeland in search of a better life in the United States. And as such, they were kind of, they pushed Andrija pretty hard. Like, he was expected to, like a lot of like first generation immigrants, like expected to grow up and become a doctor, right? Like, it's that old thing.
Yeah.
And as such, dude also loved America, right? Like, he believed in the mythic quality of America. And also, as a child, Andrija also had early interest in the mysteries of the human brain and the potential for psychic phenomena. Growing up in Chicago, Andrija excelled academically, and his curiosity about the human mind led him to pursue a career in medicine. And after completing high school, he enrolled in pre-med studies at Northwestern University, and was more like, he was interested in consciousness.
Yeah, he was interested in the brain, right?
Yeah, what makes a mind.
Yeah.
What is experience?
The nervous
what
system.
Is but more how that relates to consciousness.
Yeah.
What's the physical mechanism for the more ephemeral mind, and not just in terms of like, not in terms of necessarily poking and prodding, but what makes consciousness and energy, life energy, you know, go.
Right.
Right.
Where do thoughts take place?
Yeah.
Do they have any, like, what are they?
What are they? Are they an energy all their own?
Do they exist somewhere?
Right. And if they exist somewhere, can they go somewhere else?
Can I read someone else's?
Yeah. This was kind of he was interested in that from a fucking early age, right?
I don't blame him.
I mean,
you and me both.
Oh.
As soon as I found the, like, I forget what section of the library it was called, but in my elementary school library, which was a K-8 school,
yeah,
they had a section specifically for, like, ESP books. Like, books about the phenomena. Books about Loch Ness. Books about weird shit.
Yep.
And that
yep.
was yep. my yep. shit. Yep. I hung
Hell
out
yeah.
in that little corner of the library, and I was like, whoa. I loved Matilda. I loved
Fuck
this
yeah.
series of books named Molly Moon that was about hypnotism and psychic powers. Like, I loved this idea.
Oh, yeah,
of
dude.
Being a little girl that could somehow have magic powers and influence the world. It's why
oh,
Harry
too.
Potter popped off.
Absolutely. I was all about fucking Matilda, the, what's the Madeline Ingalls books?
A Wrinkle in Time.
Yeah, that was my shit.
Yeah.
I
also loved these books, Cirque du Freak, which was any book that had a normal human kid that had sort of this tumbling down into a world mm-hmm. that existed alongside our world, but that most people didn't know about, and only they had access to. The same reason why I've always loved Alice in Wonderland, or like The Wizard of Oz was one of my favorite movies as a kid.
Yeah.
You know, just that idea that there's this other world alongside ours.
His Dark Materials.
Yeah.
Do you ever read those?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That's that shit. But yeah, so I definitely understand it. You know, also, remember when we first recorded this, we looked up Puharich's birth chart.
Oh, I have it pulled up.
Yep, because it's actually really interesting.
Yep. Pisces sun, Pisces rising, Gemini moon in the third house, the house of communication, the house of
yep.
intellect, which is right where it's ruled by Gemini. So his moon, like that inner part of himself, really wants to study others, study like how to communicate with others, how to...
Mm-hmm.
You know, poke and prod at others. Meanwhile, his sun, his Mercury, his Venus, like his Saturn, this is all in the 12th house.
It's all 12th house Pisces?
Yeah.
Jesus fucking Christ.
Well, no, his sun is in the 12th house Pisces.
Okay.
And then the rest of it is in Aquarius.
Oh, interesting. Oh, God. Yeah.
So he's got like... his planet of communication and, like, love and, like, Mercury and Venus are both in the 12th house, which is the same for me, so I could relate to this. But that is the house of secrecy, of like occultism,
madness,
of dreams,
institutions, drugs.
Yeah, ruled by like death. Neptune and yeah.
It's the 12th house, the house of disillusion.
Yeah.
Yeah. And also, I realize why I'm so harsh on this dude too, because I also have a Pisces sun, Gemini moon. I understand you, you piece of shit.
You're a Gemini moon?
Yeah, dude. That's why everyone hates me.
Holy shit. I didn't really, you didn't mention that in the first episode,
yeah, did
you?
Yeah, definitely.
Holy fuck. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
So you have the same sun, moon.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Different houses, but still.
But all my shit's in Capricorn, which is, this, everyone just turned off this podcast, which is the other Saturn house.
And guess what? I don't even really buy into astrology that much. I'm just discussing this for the basis of the podcast, because mm-hmm. I think that it's so interesting to who Puharich is.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
it's so fascinating to me that he skews so heavily towards, like, water and air.
Water and air, yes.
He has no fucking, like,
grounding. There's
he
no
has
solidity.
No earth. No earth
that's
at
why,
all.
And that's why no one covers him as, like, a protagonist or something, because he has no impulse, no action either, right?
He literally
he's
has
a
no
fucking ghost, dude.
No grounding.
Yeah.
All
he's
of
ephemeral.
His planets.
Holy shit.
All of his major planets are in water and air.
And the whole nature of this motherfucker's character, why this series has been so hard from the start, is because this dude is a fucking ghost.
Yeah.
Like, there is no straight-up biography of this man.
Well, he's steam. Right? What does water and air together apply heat?
Yeah.
Like,
but at the same
vapor.
Time, he's like the center of like the American paranormal mystery.
Right? And it's funny how this story
Jesus
almost
Christ.
Builds more around the things around him rather than who he is, because
right.
we don't actually know much about who he is. He is a
but
ghost.
We have books that he wrote.
Yep.
We have videos of him.
And yet
it's not
we
like
can't...
we don't know.
It's and yet
so
it's hard
weird.
To trust any of it.
Right.
So it's like...
Right. You
yeah.
can't trust a goddamn thing about it.
God, moving on.
Okay, but that's very interesting. Fucking A. Okay. Just got to shake that off for a minute. Wow. He's just a bunch of hot air.
It's true.
He's a bunch of steam. Or he's an engine.
Mm-hmm.
What, like, that's what steam is. It's potential, right? Or a storm. Wow, that's so fucking wild.
If you even, like, look at his wheel and look at the transits, it's almost like all of this stuff, like, drawing down.
Oh, dude, that's exactly...
Like, drawing down into the
center. That's so close to, like, what my chart looks like, too.
Yeah.
It's weird. I think that's also why I understand this piece of shit.
Yep.
And why I hate him.
Ain't that how it goes?
All right, so in 1937, Puharich, as a teenager going into college, he won the Cook County Oratorical Contest.
Really good at public speaking.
Yeah, with an essay on George Washington. Willow, if you please, and dear audience, keep this in your pocket as we try to untangle who the fuck this man was. This is a long quote, but I think it's important.
Washington, the leader. When a man belongs to posterity, he is an alien to his contemporaries, since the effects of his work are far too reaching to be appreciated by his own generation. There is none of that familiar local color about him or his productions that appeals to the masses. There's too much of the visionary about such a man to convince the practical-minded. Speculations of this order enter the mind of an individual when contemplating the fame and leadership of George Washington. In reading the literature of the time, one is astonished at two things. First, the bitterness of the criticism directed towards Washington, especially during his second administration, bitterness which resulted from the application of his ideals. For the natural antagonism between the known, the ordinary, and the exceptional, the inventive, is always bitten. Then, secondly, that despite such criticism from the many, a strong current of loyalty from the few, furnished on inspiration, became a source of strength to him. This latter attitude did not assume the proportions of the purely personal affections accorded to such leaders as Jefferson, Jackson, or Lincoln, but it did show itself in the respect and reverence with which these people regarded him. Even in those days, some of the people vaguely felt his transcendent greatness, and since that time, posterity has proven the soundness of the faith of our forefathers, as each succeeding generation has reaffirmed their judgment. When we look at Washington's career, when we consider his foresight, his wisdom, and his statesmanship, we're not surprised at the reaction of a troubled people. They needed a man of courage, a man who possessed keen insight, a man endowed with a genius for order and justice. This man was George Washington, From the moment he took command of the revolutionary armies beneath the Cambridge Elm, the recognition of his ability as a leader was apparent. Misfortune, delay, nor disappointment could avail to completely unseat the public trust in him. They saw something in the man that assured them of a character destined for higher things.
Jesus Christ, bud.
Bro wishes he was George Washington.
So fucking bad. Like, I don't know. I think that says a little something about someone's character when they're sucking off a fucking the first president of America that hard. I don't know.
Well, he clearly has this idea of a great man.
Yeah.
This idea of the American great man.
Yeah.
And it's something that is important to him and that appeals to him.
And there's this idea of the masses who cannot understand the great man, but it's not their fault.
Right, he's
they are just small people, but they'll know in time how great this man was.
Well, I really like this idea that like he's not of this time, because I felt like Puharich always kind of had that sense about him, for better or for worse, whether or not that's like self-indulgent, because low-key, I've kind of felt that way throughout my life. Like, you know, I'm not sure I was meant for this generation. And of course I am. I love this generation.
I think.
But I've definitely had that feeling that, I sort of feel out of time. I feel out of place in this world.
Especially
as a child of Croatian immigrants.
I think he felt in place. I don't know. I think it's this like sense of, well, sometimes you have to do things that the people won't understand.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, George Washington, same sun and rising as you.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well then.
But his moon's in Capricorn.
That's what a Taurus rising does, huh?
Yeah.
I could be a great man.
Yep.
I could be president one day.
There you go.
How quickly we flip. There's just something I don't like about that story, hero worship, and like,
right.
There's something a bit Nazi about it.
So this is a speech that he won a contest for.
Yeah.
A speech about George Washington.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Weird.
He's the first president of the United States. The king of America in a way.
Exactly. Yeah. It's also like, I could see a cynical move to like win an oratorical contest. Just be like, I'm going to go for the George Washington bit.
Yeah.
In which case, I love it.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe he's not who we think he is. Maybe he's one of us. No, I don't think so.
No, I think that he related to George Washington and sought to cement a place in history for himself, similar to George Washington.
I agree. Well, in med school at Northwestern University, he wrote a bunch of journals, which he called, quote, an intellectual autobiography of Henry Puharich.
Oh my God, this is what he's doing in pre-med school?
Sounds med school, even.
Just like, yeah, I'm going to be so important one day that someone's going to want to publish my diary, so I'm just going to start writing it for them so that they can easily publish it.
This is from...
from his intellectual autobiography of Henry Puharich. God, this is self-indulgent.
It's self-indulgent.
Okay, he writes, I would venture to say that nobody really knows another's mind thoroughly. And I would venture that... I'm sorry. Can we start over from the top imagining that Puharich is writing in his live journal?
Yes.
Because that's what this fucking is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I would venture to say that nobody really knows another's mind thoroughly. And I would further venture that very few people really know their own mind. It would certainly be a great step forward for many of us if we could sit down and untangle the jungle that is our mind, and then understand those processes by which we judge and study others. If I could do a good job of a task like this, understanding the nature of a man's consciousness, I would feel that I had passed a great milestone in my education.
Yeah, if you solve the hardest unsolvable problem in all of human learning, you'd pass a great milestone in your education.
Understanding how people think and what other people are think, being able to like have a formula to that. Yeah, good fucking luck.
At this time, he also began developing a concept he called dynamics. This is a huge quote.
I visualize the human nervous system as being embedded in the cell tissue of the body. Not wrong. Just as the roots of a tree are embedded in the ground, which gives it nourishment. One end of the nervous system, as we recognize, as being in the brain. It is here that all of the messages from the body and the sense organs are localized. Other end of the nervous system is embedded directly in cell tissue through a countless number of fine nerve endings. This primary flow, however, you know, people are going to understand this when I say it like
that. Yeah. It's just a funny voice for this man with a Chicago accent.
It's his words through my voice.
No, I know. It's good. It's
yes. This primary flow, however, has some tributaries, which return the energy to the muscles and other parts of the body. This can be easily illustrated by the fact that a man can drive himself beyond his normal capacities by the force of will, which, to my way of thinking, is nothing more than the conscious diversion of this primary flow of cell energy back into the body. The point that I'm trying to establish is that the brain is an area wherein localized the cell energy of the body. I shall label this cell energy dynamics. I further venture to say that the transference of dynamics from one person to another is possible. We all know that there are people who can thrill and exhilarate one. There are others who simply bore and fatigue one. This implies that there's a wireless, touchless transfer of this vital substance, the cell energy, dynamics. If dynamics can be transferred from one organism to another, why cannot that other function of mind, thought, also be transferred from one mind to another mind? It is also conceivable that dynamics, cell energy, transfer of thought, vital substance, not only passes freely between persons, but also dissipates out into the atmosphere.
So that's
dynamics.
Puharich's theory of vibes. Psychic shit. Yeah.
It's vibes. Dynamics is vibes. Like, what are the dynamics here?
Yeah, basically.
What sort of dynamics am I walking into?
I think he does think of it as like a real energy, like on the electromagnetic
and like,
spectrum.
I kind of get what he's saying.
I do too. I mean, yeah, like I said, like, dude's a smart fucker. Like,
right. He says, we all know there are people who can thrill you, people who bore you. Like, there are people who, when you enter their electromagnetic field, it feels like they either suck from you or they're giving you something. Like, they're either positively or negatively charged against your battery. Maybe not towards everybody, but with you and that person, there's something about your batteries, about your electromagnetic signature that's just like, whoop, that doesn't work.
There's patterns of signals that then flip switches.
Right. So he's just thinking about these things that we've all thought of and we all have our own terms and names for.
Yeah.
But he's trying to put that into scientific terms and see if he can measure that somehow.
I think the thing he doesn't get, though, is that like the thoughts arise in the person, but you transfer thoughts by a collection of signals that flip different switches and you hope to flip the right switches to make another person's version of a same thought. But he's over here thinking that like a thought is like a packet of energy itself and like a Wi-Fi signal.
Whereas, you know, like sometimes I'll be hanging out with my partner and I'll notice that their voice is like getting dry because I'll notice that I'm starting to hear that more. And that's when I'll pass them a glass of water and they'll be like, oh my God, are you psychic?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I was just thinking about how I wanted to have water.
Yeah.
And I'm like, no, man, I was just paying attention to your cues. I could hear your voice getting dry, you know? So I'm not psychic. I'm just highly attuned to your needs. And sometimes it'd be like that with other people.
Sometimes it'd be like that.
You know?
I mean, at the same time, though, as I've said many times, the one paranormal phenomenon I will go to bat for every fucking time is the psychic shit.
And like, I'm prone to agree.
Yeah. Like, I'm...
There's something with that, but I also do think that there has to be a certain, like, energetic signature, if you will, that is attuned and in accordance with one's own in order for you to be able to pick up on it. I don't think that you can accidentally pick up on someone's shit without there being, like, something there.
We'll get into that. There's some interesting experiments we'll talk about later on.
Sweet.
Touch on that. Yeah, I don't know. Like, so I have no idea what the psychic phenomenon is.
He's a medical doctor, right?
This man's a medical doctor.
But his research is primarily focused on this shit.
That's his interest. Like, that's what he wants to be a doctor for.
Okay.
To, like, find the medical cause of this shit. Like, the actual physical fucking...
See if that's even possible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he's attacking it kind of from that angle.
Mm-hmm.
A more like macro scale than I feel like a lot of people
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. All right. So in 1943, he earned his MD while maintaining his psychic research, his interest in psychic research. And then, like, I don't know how many of the assholes we've talked about, World War II interrupted Puharich's education, and he enlisted in the U.S. Army Medical Corps. As a lieutenant, he was stationed in Nuremberg, treated both U.S. soldiers and German POWs in a military hospital.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. He, and witnessing the psychological trauma of war firsthand, Puharich saw what it did to the brain. The effects of trauma on the mind and shit.
PTSD,
the potential for altered states of consciousness.
Oh, it's a hell of a thing.
It's a real-ass thing.
We talked about it in previous episodes, especially in our Harriet Tubman episode, how PTSD mm-hmm. and trauma plays into one's ability to enter altered states, experience trance, perhaps have visions of the future.
Yeah. And I mean, we'll talk about some of the sort of biological theories that Puharich had on this a bit later on, dealing with like the parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous systems and shit like that. On December 9th, 1947, Puharich gets discharged from the army because of a persistent ear infection.
Damn.
Yeah. He goes to a party, he meets this dude, Paul de Kruijf, a science writer, and they have this like great drunken conversation about Andrija's theories on like how nerves work and shit. And like the next morning, the conversation was so good that despite how fucking hungover he was from the night before, Paul de Kruijf remembered their discussion, called Puharich up and was like, you should start a lab. Like, let's just start you a fucking lab, a neurological institute in Santa Barbara.
Paul de Kruijf got money?
He made a bunch of phone calls.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
Paul de Kruijf got charisma.
Yeah. That's pretty much the end of Paul de Kruijf in here.
He got connections.
Yeah.
He's the networking guy.
He just was. Point is, he just
So this goes to show you, because little point of wisdom for our listeners and for anyone. Those little drunken conversations that you have with people at parties mm-hmm. where you don't know really who they are, but you're kind of just bullshitting.
Dude, shit can come about from that.
Take their card, put it in your wallet. You might not remember the conversation the next day, but, you know, that stuff, that's how you actually get ahead in life.
It adds up. It adds up.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Anyway, it didn't add up for Paul, really, because, like...
But he sets things in motion for Andrija.
Well, hold on a second. In California, Andrija has a whole bunch of things set up, right?
Okay.
Things are going to go so great for him. He's got all these benefactors and shit. He gets his medical discharge, and then he decides to visit his father and stepmother in Chicago before going to New York and Boston to meet other scientists for this institute. His father, like, asks him to go see these two Yugoslavians up in Camden, Maine.
Yugoslav violinists.
Yes, Zlatko Bolokovic, a Yugoslav violinist, and his wife, Joyce.
Okay, so they're chilling in Maine. They're probably like, ooh, we're good.
They're rich as fuck.
Good for the Bolokovics.
Yeah, they're rich as fuck from Yugoslavia, and I'm not really sure what the promise to his father was, but...
This is like Christmas time, too.
Yeah.
So he's just discharged from medical school.
Discharged from the army. He's got his MD.
Okay.
He's got Paul de Kruijf that's helping him set up a fucking new neurological institute in Santa Barbara. And then he just goes up to this violin player's house in Maine, right? And they start like talking about all this stuff. And they had a mutual interest in philosophy, medicine, and psychic research. And Joyce introduces Andrija to like the actual psychic stuff. Like, you know, the possibility of people possessing powers like Jesus. Like, maybe Jesus was a psychic.
You know? Maybe Jesus was an alien.
Maybe Jesus was an alien. Maybe Jesus was Uri Geller. It starts early. I didn't even realize it starts this early. Yeah, like, this Joyce lady, like, introduces...
Joyce Bolokovic.
Yeah.
And is she Yugoslav or her husband just says?
I know Zlatko is. I don't know about Joyce.
Okay.
But, like...
But now they're friends with Andrija.
Well, so they're, like, sitting around this fire... You know, it's Christmas time. They're having this fine Yugoslavian liquor. They're fucking really rich up in Maine. Joyce is telling Andrija, like, what if Jesus was actually a psychic? What if there's other people like that?
What's Andrija's religion? Like, what was he raised with? Do we know?
No, I don't know. Probably.
No idea.
I mean, probably Catholic or Orthodox or something. I don't know.
He was raised Roman Catholic.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah. But I mean, I don't know how much he really cared. Well, she basically, like, you know the story of Jesus, right? Like,
okay, so Jesus does have a place in his heart, though.
Yes.
Probably, as growing up, going to, like, Roman Catholic schools.
But I think it was more like, it wasn't necessarily like, yo, what if there's another Jesus? It's more like, well, you know there's all these people that can do all this ESP stuff. You know there's, like, practicing psychics, right? Like, there's all this shit, then, yeah, I've always had ideas about that. I always thought that might be a thing. Well, you know, think about Jesus. Like, all those abilities, like, there's people today that can do all those things, right? So it's more like, oh, maybe Jesus wasn't that special. Maybe it's just this untapped faculty in human brain. What if it's not miraculous? What if it's just psi? But at the same time.
Right. So like, what if Jesus almost represents like this, almost like the Ubermensch, like the unlocked potential of man if they could only unlock those powers. But most people can't because they are not like Jesus. But if they could be like Jesus, then they could possess powers like him.
Well, also like definitely from the perspective that Jesus was a person that was alive.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah.
Okay, so they're all just hanging out in Maine, just talking about this shit. They're so fucking drunk, talking about Jesus' powers.
Puharich stays for 3 weeks, falls in love with the coastal town, and then feels a strong, almost irrational conviction that he needs to return and build a laboratory here, up in Maine. So he just fucks off from the Neurological Institute in California.
Santa Barbara.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where he was going to be the director.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fuck you, Paul DeCroix.
Fuck you, Paul DeCroix.
Fuck all the phone calls you made for me.
I'm going to Maine.
Thanks, bro. But nah. I'm just going to burn all those bridges.
I'm
just going
to go live by these rich Slavs.
No, they'll accept him when he goes back to California, though.
He does.
He'll find his people there.
I don't think he goes back to California.
He doesn't?
He's a Maine man now.
Fuck yeah. He has the vibes of a California man. I don't know why.
He's a Maine man.
I guess it's because he's from Chicago and that's the same trajectory that the IM people's folks.
That's true. Yeah.
They took. They went from Chicago to LA.
Oh, dude, that's
so
how.
So I guess I'm just expecting that because it feels like similar flavors, but nah.
That's how weird Andrija Puharich is.
That he doesn't go to LA. He goes to Maine instead.
In Maine. And every.
Camden, Maine.
Maine's weird, dude. Maine's a weird state. Yeah. It makes sense. He's got Maine vibes.
So by the end of his 3 weeks with the Bolakovics, he's like, yep, this is where my lab is.
Yeah, he wrote that it was like an irrational pull towards fucking Maine.
This is where I'm going to do all my animal research.
Near Stephen King's house.
Yes. Like, this is where I'm going to form my own pet cemetery.
Yeah, basically.
Of dead
so like what
roosters.
What he wanted to do was... the first thing he was setting up was a lab to study nerve research on animals.
Yep.
Yeah. So
at
he had
cemetery.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is just like a creepy thing to do, by the way. It's just.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No.
Yeah. It sucks. Well, he started practicing medicine again to make ends meet. In December 1948, his neighbor, Roy Hines, offered him a barn to use as a lab. And there's like no heat or anything. And he was just building this fucking mind lab in a Maine barn. In the middle of winter with like negative 20 degree temperatures and shit.
And you know when you're Maine, your neighbor means that he's like 5 miles away. No, probably closer than that, but.
It's cold enough they got to stay kind of close together.
Little bit, just for emergencies.
Yeah, Jesus.
It's good to be friends with your neighbors, by the way.
And also, this is like coastal Maine. This is like the area where like the bushes live and shit.
Mm.
Like this is so that fucking rich Maine.
Yes, but it's also insulated. Like, it's a small community, but rich community.
Extremely rich.
Okay.
Yeah. This is where the Bush family lives. This is where, well...
Camden?
Not necessarily Camden, but, like, that area, Penobscot Bay and shit. Yeah, I forget the town the Bushes live in, but it's right around there. It's that same cove, essentially.
Mm.
And that's why there's all the fucking Astors and DuPonts and shit that are part of the Round Table Foundation, right? It's just that it's where they live.
Oh yes, the Round Tables. Yeah. We'll get to that.
That's what we're working on. Yeah. So yeah, the Balakovics got him a $13,000 in grant by June 1949. He got a couple assistants. The barn became a home to a bunch of research animals. His first research project was conducted with Dr. Samuel Rosen, a New York hearing specialist on conductive deafness. So that's like using nerve stimulation to get you hearing back.
Yeah.
Right?
It's also interesting to note because I'm 27. He's like 30 at this time in his life.
Yeah, he's like 30. Yeah, he's younger than me.
He's our contemporary.
Yeah, he's younger than I am right now, which makes me feel great. Thank you for bringing it up.
Well, no, it's just, I think it's interesting to think about his story from that point of view because I used to read about stuff and
assume it was just an older person.
Yeah, all adults sort of went above the same like barrier where it was just like they're an adult, don't really relate to that experience.
No,
but now we're talking
right
at
now.
A man at a time in his life where he's very much at the same point in life that you and I are essentially at.
Yeah.
So to think about the things that he's doing, the mindset that he's in, the person that he is, I feel a closer connection with that. even though it's back in, you know, 1949. I don't
have fucking $13,000 in grants from some fucking rich slobs.
Well, if anyone's listening, patreon.com/thenonsensebazaar.
All right, so Buhark's second big break was in November 1949 when he met Eileen Garrett, founder of the Parapsychological Foundation in New York.
Okay.
And a psychic herself. A renowned psychic.
All right. Eileen Garrett, renowned psychic.
Founder of the Parapsychological Foundation.
Yeah. Okay.
Garrett introduced Andrija to her friend John Hayes Hammond Jr., a renowned electrical inventor. Electronic inventor.
That sounds like a folk punk artist.
John Hayes Hammond Jr.?
Yes.
Yeah. Absolutely. So, fucking Puharich visited Hammond's home in Gloucester, Massachusetts in 1949. And that resulted in a long-lasting friendship. Hammond's home was described as a medieval castle filled with antiques, art, and technology. It left a lasting impression on Andrija. And Hammond helped him, like, learned how to invent.
Basically, like, a mentor. He
mentored him in, like, electronic engineering and invention and shit. And
sweet.
And this medieval castle with, like, you know, portraits of great people, right, and very much part of that.
Because it sounds like Puharich has done a lot of research and has a lot of background and, like, collegiate study having to do with the medical, biological side of things. He understands how the human body works.
Yeah.
So now to get a greater background in technology
and
electronics, he can start to synthesize these two things.
Yeah, absolutely.
Especially having a mentor like this.
Yeah, absolutely. I hadn't even, like, thought of it. Like, where did he learn how to do electronics engineering? I was just, like, assumed that he just learned those things. But it's like, no, you got to get taught that. He got taught that by this dude, John Hayes Hammond Jr., who, like, had some serious fucking old money ass, you know, stewards of culture bullshit. Remember, this is the richest of the rich people.
Right.
Yeah. So by March 27th, 1951, Puharich began his experiments with Eileen and Hammond to explore telepathy. They faced numerous challenges. The Belakovics got damn near run out of town for being communists.
No. Probably just Yugoslavs. Come on.
Yeah. The FBI checked up on Puharich and shit.
What are you doing, you fucking Croatian bastard?
I'm from Chicago.
I'm American. What are you talking about?
Why does everyone keep getting this wrong? Well, your name's Andrija.
Right, but it's not. Enough. It's Henry.
It's Henry. I'm Henry. Well, eventually, one of Puharich's patrons, Mr. Walter Cabot Payne, that you might
of the cheese fame?
Different Cabot, but probably richer.
Of
old
the
money.
Payne fame?
Yes.
Of the Thomas Paine fame?
Yeah, as in, like,
who's Thomas Paine?
Thomas
Paine
was
name?
The
he's the pamphlet guy. He wrote a pamphlet.
Yeah, he wrote inflammatory propaganda.
Yeah.
I
paid enough attention.
See, Puharich liked George Washington. I liked Thomas Paine as a kid. That was my favorite of the American.
Yeah, that guys. Enlightenment shit.
No, just that real inflammatory fucking.
Well, I love the idea of just being able to, like, fan the flames of an entire country's political system by just, like, sending out some flyers.
By doing words good.
Yeah.
I'll make you real mad.
So Walter Cabot Payne is a patron of Andrija's.
Yeah, and, like, the Cabots are, like, an old money Boston family, right?
He's like, we
the
got
Paynes
enough,
are, like, an old fucking family.
Got enough money, just throw it here, there. All right, well, you sound interesting. What are you doing? You're doing some psychic research? Yeah, that sounds interesting. Yeah,
oh, they
here,
love that.
Go for it.
They love it.
Yeah, have fun.
Yeah, they got the fucking the Warrington estate for $35,000 from Walter Cabot Payne.
65 acres.
65 acres in Glen Cove.
Glen Cove. Ooh, that sounds fancy in Maine. Yeah. 65 acres.
Yeah. Long way from a barn in a couple
Getting
years.
Getting the Warrington estate, upgrading from that barn. Okay. Fucking Roy Hines, thank you very much for your neighborly barn.
Remember, Puharich won the oratorical contest.
That charisma score.
In its early years, the Roundtable Foundation focused on several key areas of research, including telepathy, clairvoyance, and psychokinesis. Puharich was particularly interested in finding ways to measure psychic abilities objectively and developing techniques that could amplify or control psychic energy.
Okay, so the Roundtable Foundation is basically founded at this new estate.
Yeah, it's like
by him, Eileen, and this John Hayes Hammond Jr.
And, like, you've
and
got
a few other people.
Well, yeah, a few other people for sure. We mention a lot of this in our episode on The Nine. Think of that episode as, like, part of this series. You know, it's fucking Ruth Forbes Payne Young, an Astor, or I think she might be a fucking, one of them is an Astor, a DuPont, Marcella DuPont, Alice Bouverie. Yeah, Alice Bouverie, who is an Astor, as in, like, the Waldorf Astoria, you know.
One of the Maine families.
Yeah. Like one
and
of
not
those
the Maine
families.
With an E families, not both. The state of Maine family. Both.
Yeah.
Yes, you're right.
Are there pal arounds like Vannevar Bush and shit? I mean, fucking Henry Wallace was a member of the Roundtable Foundation. He was a financial backer. He was fucking FDR's Secretary of Agriculture and then Vice President, who was like the
exist?
The co-architect of the New Deal. What's that?
Are they still active?
No.
It's just another thing calling itself the Roundtable
Foundation. Yeah, it's a different thing. Yeah.
The Eileen Garrett Roundtable Foundation is a different thing.
Oh, interesting.
Okay. So just for anyone that tries to look this up, there is something called the Roundtable Foundation that exists right now, but that's not what we're talking about.
Right. This Roundtable Foundation only lasted until 1960 or so, I believe. It was like a 10-year deal.
And I feel like Eileen Garrett was one of the big progenitors in like making it happen. Am I correct in that assumption?
Yes.
Her
yes.
and Puharich
and
equally.
Alice Bouverie and Ruth Forbes Payne Young.
So it's just like a collective of people.
Yeah. Yeah. Puharich's the scientist, right. But it's this board of people that are interested in psychic shit. Parapsychological research and shit. They also have the psychics Harry Stone and Peter Hurkos would be there. I mean, I think there's the board, right? Right. I mean, and Arthur Young is another big one. He was a big part of this. Mm-hmm. The dude who invented the Bell helicopter. Another fucking genius inventor, way too much right. fucking money, who's very interested in this
so
mystic
this,
shit.
This foundation, it forms like, for what reason exactly? Just all of these people are more or less interested in the same fields of research and decide that we want to pool our collective knowledge, our collective resources in order to keep learning about these things?
Essentially, yeah.
Okay.
And like,
just want to be clear about what
yeah.
it is.
Right. Yeah. So they wanted to be the science parapsychology lab, like the actual, we're testing this objectively with technology, yeah. all this shit. I mean, Aldous Huxley went there and he like wrote very nice thing. He was very impressed by the parapsychology lab, which was, you know, as you might imagine, kind of just like today, like people didn't take that seriously. Like, they were trying to be the interdisciplinary, you know,
right.
fucking real ass parapsychology lab.
And this is the part of Andrija Puharich's career that people like and admire him for, right?
Absolutely.
You
100%.
Know, because he used his scientific background, his medical background to try and lend some credence to the world of psychical research, which not a lot of people had really done meaningfully in America up until this point.
Absolutely.
And that's a huge contribution. So people do look upon him favorably for that, and I can understand why.
She gets real weird real fast, though.
It absolutely does.
Like,
way too fast. Just nine bullshit? I mean, listen to the episode.
Honestly, no, it goes, I mean, this is all like, yeah, we're gonna figure out if psychic shit's real. But also, like LaVenda says, it's
sound
looks
I
like
just
a
made.
Fucking prayer meeting of the Association of Former Intelligence Officers.
Yeah.
These are if there are Illuminati, it's them.
They're this all just mind fucking each other.
Yeah, it's fucking ridiculous. So Puharich became interested in the prospect of using Faraday cage to enhance Eileen Garrett's psychic powers. So for this, they got a research grant from perhaps some CIA connections of nearly $100,000.
Guys, good Lord, go on.
So Puharich constructs a Faraday cage to study the mysterious phenomenon of extrasensory perception. But like, what happens when you put a metal cage around it?
Let's get a fucking $100,000 cage, put it around Eileen Garrett, see what happens.
Basically. Yeah, it made her better at it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. November 1952, his experiments yielded astonishing results, showing a significant increase in ESP within the confines of the cage. And now, this is around the time that Puharich also gave a talk to the Army about the potential for paranormal weaponry.
Hello,
and it's always
military.
Described like that, paranormal weaponry.
Yeah.
Not psychic, paranormal weaponry. Yeah, and in December 1952, Puharich's drafted into the Army.
Army? The American Army?
Yeah. As a medical doctor at a place called Edgewood Arsenal.
Yeah, I mean, well, he's had experience. He's been in the Army before.
Now, if y'all motherfuckers don't know about Edgewood Arsenal, this place was fucked. This is one of the most fucked places in American history.
Was he drafted into it? I'm willing to bet his time at Edgewood, I don't think it was drafted. You know, I don't think he was forced into his position there.
From 1940 until 1973, during both peacetime and periods of conflict, people were drafted into the U.S. Armed Forces.
But so, including like, into like medical doctorate positions, like doctors could be drafted?
Especially those positions.
Wow. Sorry. I guess I just have a huge blind spot on American history in that area because I had no idea.
I'm pretty sure, like, yeah, they're drafted to fill vacancies in the U.S. Armed Forces that could not be filled through voluntary means. When you've got like something like a doctor, I can imagine you might end up short.
Doctors, nurses, and other medical technicians could be drafted in the event of, yeah, even nowadays, that's still in place. Sorry, doctors.
Yeah, so I mean, that's what it says. But like, also, he's around all these fucking military people. Like, I don't know how it happened. Do you know what I mean?
However it happened, he was there and it was the perfect place for him to be to do what he wanted to do.
Yeah, and he was also like bouncing back and forth too. Like, so he definitely was like, I don't know how much, it wasn't like he got sent to boot camp. You know what I mean? They probably said, hey, bud, we need your help on something over here at Edgewood.
Right. Which is,
and the thing about Edgewood,
that's in Maryland?
Yeah.
Okay.
Fort Detrick.
So still East Coast. He's not having to travel like.
But what they did at Edgewood is very interesting.
God, yes.
Edgewood is where the first LSD experiments happened. And that's the fun part. They also tested a whole bunch of other chemical warfare agents. A lot of drugs on unsuspecting U.S. soldiers. Involuntarily.
Yep.
Some motherfuckers died. Other motherfuckers had real bad times.
Yep. There was that drug EA-3167. Look this shit up if you want to have an afternoon on the internet that like drives you crazy. Read about this drug. It was developed under contract specifically for Edgewood, and it lasted 5 to 10 days.
Jesus.
Yeah, an anticholinergic delirium drug. And if you listen to our Benadryl episode, well,
that's precisely Puharich's area of specialty.
Know about anticholinergics and deliriums and what they can fucking do to you. Imagine that lasting 5 to 10 days, because the time dilation just within a small dose that lasts for an afternoon feels crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like you're gone forever. So if you're gone forever for 10 days, that's an eternity in another place.
Yeah. And
that's what they were putting people through.
Yeah. And a lot of these were made from Datura, which is also where scopolamine comes from. That like device did that thing, the truth drug that you, Columbia blowed in your face.
And again, the name of that drug for those who are curious is EA-3167.
Word.
Just because I think a 5 to 10 day lasting deliriant is like, whoa, what the fuck are you doing?
Yeah. No, dude, and like that's precisely the shit the type of drugs he was working on.
That could be administered through a handshake too, just a little teeny tiny teeny itty bitty bit of it, and you could cause someone to go fucking insane.
Jesus Christ!
Administer that shit through a handshake, and then your opponent, that whoever you give that to, they're gone for the next 10 days. If you use that strategically, oh man!
Jesus Christ! So that's Edgewood, yeah,
they're
doing all sorts of fun shit.
So he's there.
He's making that shit. I mean, that's what he was working on, you know? But he's also bouncing back and forth between there and fucking the goddamn Roundtable Foundation. And, like, it's right before he goes to Edgewood for the first time that they channel the Nine, New Year's Eve, 1952 into 1953. Again, go listen to that. Like, that's happening right at this time where...
And for those, you know, the Nine, just give a sentence to it. It's a group of nine entities.
And this motherfucker... Dr. Vinod channeled this thing calling itself the nine principles and forces that like proves itself by finishing one of Einstein's equations or something and then apparates nine pieces of string that they give to the people watching this fiasco, which who are again an Astor, a DuPont, a fucking, you know,
the Roundtable
Foundation, telling them that this represents it's some Indian thing that means they're the new Brahmin, which is like the highest caste, you know, the enlightened ones and shit, the
divine synthesis between male and female, like to be the state of Brahma. That's like
a different word.
Yeah. No, different.
Yeah. Different. Yeah. It's the same word, but it's two different things. Yeah. Yeah.
Cut that out.
I will. Yeah, no, Brahmin is like the highest caste system. And then there's Brahma, which is
Brahma, God. Brahmin, different.
Yeah. It's unfortunately a different thing. But you could see
in there because that's educational.
But like, he's making this weird drugs right after this. And this is
Jesus Christ.
This is history, guy. This isn't even conspiracy. This is history.
This is just what happened.
Like, We're not even into the speculation yet. Well, I don't know if he actually made that drug himself, but that's what he was working on. Well, yeah, so just keep in mind Puharich was directly involved, no doubt, in some of the most unethical and twisted stuff we've ever done as a nation, officially. Well, his work also captured the attention of CIA's technical services staff, which was intrigued by his work with telepathy and clairvoyance and, you know, the whole thing with the nine. Because, like...
So, this whole alien...
These guys... Because these guys... I said you were channeling aliens with my wife. That's why I got drafted. you know, or maybe it was just through because he was buddies with fucking Arthur Young and Henry Wallace.
He knew a lot of important, powerful people.
He was just who you'd go talk to if you needed somebody in this capacity.
Right, which makes him a vulnerable person.
Vulnerable or just the guy?
Well, it makes him vulnerable to outside influences who see him as a point that could influence and connect with other important people.
That's true. And I think he thought he was using all of them.
Right.
Yeah. We'll see how this all goes for everybody who's involved.
Who's
using who? We will see.
Who's pulling the strings here? Dr. Vinod.
I mean, Puharich does just go fucking crazy by the end of this.
Can't wait.
Yeah. Oh, however it happened, Puharich was recruited by CIA as a consultant to Project Artichoke, which was a competing program to Project MKULTRA. It's often reported that that Project Artichoke led into MKULTRA, but in fact, it was just another mind control program.
Two different projects run by like different people.
By different people. You know, for pretty much the same goals, but with like
different supervisors,
different specific end goals. Project Artichoke was very much about creating assassins.
Okay.
Yeah, that was that. And it was, you know, Morse Allen was running Project Artichoke, while Sidney Gottlieb was running MKUltra.
Both those names.
Yeah.
Straight out of a fucking pulp novel.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Sidney Gottlieb, the poisoner in chief. Morse Allen is the most CIA fucking name I've ever heard in my life.
Hard boiled.
Yeah. Yeah. So if you want to learn more about the CIA conspiracy side of Puharich's life, because there's a lot. There's a lot to be read about MKUltra. Who'd have thunk it?
He's spooky.
Recluse on the Visa blog has done some great writing and what is it? What's the word when you pull a bunch of shit together?
Archiving, compilation,
compiling a bunch of the various, you know, anecdotes and information that you have to glean from all these different fucking
Where
books
can you
about
Mark.
Visupview.blogspot.com.
How do you spell that? Like
V-I-S-U-P.
Oh.
V-I-S-U-P. Yeah.
That's funny because that phonetically, like, it sounds like Weishaupt.
Like Adam Weishaupt?
Yeah.
No, but it's not.
Weishaupt.
Yeah.
That's what I thought you were saying.
No, it's not. He doesn't run the Weishaupt. So this is, here's a quote from one of the Artichoke documents. Here's a quote from one of the Artichoke documents stating its objectives.
Evaluation and development of any method by which we can get information from a person against his will and without his knowledge. Can we get control of an individual to the point where he will do our bidding against his will and even against such fundamental laws of nature such as self-preservation? Yes, you can.
Yep. And here's old Spookface himself, Alan Dulles, in a secret memo writing about Artichoke.
Who's Alan Dulles?
Alan Dulles. He fucking old Spookface. He was,
Founder of the CIA?
Not the first head of the CIA, but him and his brother, what the fuck is his brother? His brother was Secretary of State when he was head of the CIA, and under his ass...
He was director of it.
Yeah, he was director of CIA, and it was under his ass that, like, CIA got real fucking crazy, overthrowing governments and shit. I mean, he was chair of the fucking Warren Commission and shit. Like, he's a little spook face, dude. He's one of the big, great bastards of history.
So this is a memo writing about Project Artichoke. He says, in our conversation on 9 February 1951, I outlined to you the possibilities of augmenting the usual interrogation methods by the use of drugs, hypnosis, shock, etc., and emphasized the defensive aspects as well as the offensive opportunities in this field of applied medical science. The enclosed folder, Interrogation Techniques, was prepared in my medical division to provide you with a suitable background.
Yeah. Drugs, hypnosis, shock, etc. Yeah, he's just involved in all this spook shit in like a couple years. And this comes from like a lot of
Well, they want him for a reason.
Yeah.
You know, this didn't just happen out of nowhere. There was a precedent set where they saw what he was doing with the Roundtable Foundation. Yeah. They saw his neuropsychological, biological research, whatever he was doing with that shit.
Right.
His hearing aid stuff, the stuff with implanting devices into people's teeth. Did we talk about that?
We haven't talked about that yet.
My goodness.
Well, we'll get there.
So there was definitely a precedent for why the CIA would be interested in this man and being like, hey.
Remember, he's the guy that wants to synthesize all the fields to understand what is a mind. And that's what they're interested in.
Truly, though.
And he's channeling aliens with all their wives.
So he might as well, hey, come here.
But, you know, it's this is also often presented as like sort of evidence of a contradictory nature of Puharich's character, that he's doing all this work with the Roundtable Foundation and then all this work with the government and shit.
No.
It's not contradictory at all.
No.
No. He wasn't living a double life. Like, that sort of relies on an assumption that parapsychology is essentially harmless. A fun little goof-em-up fun time with the rich old ladies. And if there's...
He was doing the same shit at both places.
Right. If there's anything at all to psychic abilities, it changes the story entirely. But even if there's nothing to it, consider this. Even if there's psychic abilities, I'll give it to you. I mean, they don't exist at all. We're all crazy. It's fine. However, 20 years after this, the CIA and Army Intelligence took a keen interest in psi phenomena, along with Stanford Research Institute. So even if you don't believe it...
Well, listen to our Psychic Spy episode.
Yeah.
Episodes.
Yeah, go listen to our Psychic Spy episodes. Even if you don't believe it, we know they did. Right? That's the important part.
And also, as we have learned from a lot of our episodes... Ultimately, at the end of the day, oftentimes the truth doesn't really matter. It matters what people believe in and how that impacts our reality.
Absolutely.
So whether or not all this psychic research, we have the meat and bones to back it up, whatever, they were doing this.
They were doing it. The people running the government were doing it. We also know how absolutely lousy with intelligence connections the Roundtable Foundation was. It's just my opinion, but I will die on this fucking hill. Like, these supposedly contradictory parts of Andrija Puharich's character are not at all contradictory. It's one thing. Remember, we legitimately do not know the extent of the military and intelligence experiments with behavior modification. Sidney Gottlieb burned a lot of fucking papers. Like, we don't know.
I'm sure it goes deep. I'm a mind-controlled sex slave.
I mean,
I am.
Jesus Christ. And this is also, after all, when the whole saga with the Nine started. And so the other thing about the Nine episode, again, go listen to it, is that the dude who channeled the Nine, Dr. Vinod. Oh, actually, this is the clip where this is actually super important.
Okay.
Yeah. Because it talks about how he was friends with Henry Wallace.
Henry Wallace?
Vice President under FDR.
Ah.
One of the architects of the New Deal, the dude who should have been the guy to drop the bomb if it wasn't for the Democratic political machine, like super important character in American history. This is Puharich talking about that period in his life and channeling the Nine at that time.
In the early 50s, actually about 1950, I was in New York City. I lived in Maine, had a laboratory there, was doing animal work, human work, Faraday cage and so on and so on. And I was young, I didn't know that much, you know, a lot of brass, but not knowledge. So one of the things that happened was I was in New York City, and I went to a reception given by a very famous lady in parapsychology at that time, named Eileen Garrett. And she had, as a visiting guest from India, a nice little guy in a narrow jacket and so on, with glasses, and you know, it could have been anybody's uncle. It was nothing conspicuous. And he was very quiet, and we met in the corner, and I asked him, you know, what he does. He's from the University of Pune, and here on a peace mission, and so on and so on. And he said, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm studying parapsychology, and trying to find out the ultimate reaches of the mind so I can finally design a brain. I mean, that's where my head was in those days, right? So he said, well, we must get together. I said, how long are you going to be in the country? Oh, he said, I'll be here for about 6 months, and maybe I'll get a renewal. So I said, fine, I'll get together with you. Well, I left him, and other events intervened. 6 months went by, a year went by, and every once in a while I think, gee, maybe I'll call him up, but I didn't. So one day I was up in Upper Westchester County area visiting with former Vice President of the United States, Henry Wallace, was a good friend of mine. We did a lot of agricultural experiments together. And we got stuck a little bit on the statistics on an experiment we were running, so I missed the train I was going to take back to New York City. And I missed it by about 2 hours, and I did have an appointment in New York City. So he rushed me to the nearest town, which is Pleasantville, New York, known for Reader's Digest, put me on a train there. I got on the train, and I sat down, kind of running all day, you know. And the last guy gets on the train, he comes late, and it's this Dr. Enoch. He sits next to me, he says, oh, he says, time for us, you know, Indians talk with a little high-pitched voice. He says, it's time we ought to get together, right? And, you know, I guess so we've been caught up with. Make a long story short, I invited him up to my laboratory in Maine, which is near Rockland, and he came in by plane. One of my colleagues had picked him up. He walked into the house, which is a very famous Stanford-like place, huge, and walked into the library and sat down without giving us any warning, went into trance and started speaking. We are nine principles and forces, personalities of the wish, and we plan this to the ultimate, blah, 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 blah.
So that's the precursor to the nine. And that just shows how fucking spooked up this dude is. Like, he's just hanging out with Henry Wallace. This dude shows up on a fucking train out of nowhere after meeting him in New York City.
Yeah.
After he's 2 hours late for this train.
Yeah.
Has to get driven to another. Like, that's just weird. It's very weird. I did a little research after we did our episode on the nine. Turns out this Dr. Vinod character, he was a one-time head of a Theosophical Society chapter in India.
Because as we were listening to that clip, I was trying to find if Puharich had ever had any connections with anthroposophy, because Rudolf Steiner was very into agriculture specifically.
I'm sure.
So, and you know,
I think Steiner Henry Wallace was actually into anthroposophy.
Yeah, because that has a huge emphasis on agriculture and farming.
Yeah.
The relationship of the land to man and nature.
Yeah.
I was trying to figure out if I could find a concrete connection to that, but it makes sense.
Yeah, I think Henry Wallace was very interested in theosophy, according to things I've read.
Yeah.
Theosophy and anthroposophy. So, yeah. So there's the theosophy thing again. And in the bonus episode this week, we're talking about the secret text, historical text that Helena Blavatsky based.
Oh, yes, secret doctrine we are.
On. Yeah.
The ancient text written in Senzar, the universal language that she used to form her formation of the idea of the creation of the universe.
It's a whole bunch of nonsense. And yeah, we're talking about it this week on our bonus series. All right. So yeah, Vinod, theosophist. There's a theosophy connection as well.
What's his first name? Do we even know?
No.
Or he's just Dr. Vinod. His first name is Dr.
Like, I'm sure he has a name.
Yeah, but he's kind of just like...
never read it.
This mythical character.
Everyone in this fucking story is... None of this ever actually happened.
Nope.
Like, that's the other thing, guys. I'm sorry, but like, that's also a very real possibility, is that like, none of this is true.
Right. It's like how you'll find accounts of Andrija Puharich having a brother named Henry Puharich, and you're like, no.
No, that's him.
That's him.
Yeah.
Confusing the fucking plot.
Yeah. There's a lot of plot confusion.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
There sure is.
And it's only going to get worse for the next 3 weeks. So, congratulations.
Buckle in.
Buckle up and fuck you. No, this is important. We have to do this, guys. I'm telling you. So, as you might guess, though, not everyone at CIA and Edgewood was a fan of Puharich's more outlandish ideas.
The fuck is this nine bullshit?
Yeah, who's this fucking guy? What are we doing? He faced a fair share of adversaries during his time with the government, even within MKULTRA and Artichoke, right? One of Puharich's earliest opponents was Frank Olson, who met his untimely end through suicide, quote-unquote, in November 1953.
Suicide.
Suicide.
Wink. Wink.
Suicide out of a high-rise window on LSD.
Suspicious.
I don't know why so many people connected to various state departments choose that way to go out.
You know?
It's just odd. Something about the job, I guess.
I'm sure it's just a coincidence.
Well, Puharich had already butted heads with Olson, who was a chemist with CIA, before being called back into the army. Puharich was an open supporter of esoteric subjects, making claims about our abilities to communicate with higher intelligences and shit, and Olson was fairly skeptical of such notions. In mid-1952, during a Chemical Corps Biological Division briefing on hallucinogenic plants, Frank Olson threw a snide remark at Puharich. Not one to take it lying down, Puharich challenged Olson to a debate, calling him a, quote,
"Oh, frightened schoolboy who had not yet managed to overcome his fear of the dark."
Which is a savage line coming from a mad scientist.
You know, might not be too untrue, though.
Absolutely.
These people who are so vehemently against engaging with esotericism and engaging with religion, like these dogmatic atheists that you'll meet, it's like, bro, what are you scared of?
I can just like kind
scared
of...
Scared of something.
Yeah, but and it's just as that creepy as... Like, I can imagine, like, Puharich, like, standing up, like, pointing at this man and, like, seeing his fucking crate and, like, the lights get dim.
You frightened schoolboy.
Thunder cracks. He's not yet managed to overcome his fear of the dark.
Like, but he
Jesus
hasn't.
Christ. And he got tossed out of the window. Or maybe he was just a good guy.
Well, he was also on a shitload of LSD without knowing it.
Well, I don't think all the time. I think he was a chemist most of the time, but he did get tossed out of a fucking window.
Yeah.
Yeah. Apparently, this argument could have turned into a fistfight had it not been for the intervention of the Chemical Corps' medical director, Puharich's friend, Colonel Norman Elton.
All right, boys, settle down.
Basically. But no one appeared to clash more with Puharich within the CIA than stage magician John Mulholland.
It's always a fucking stage magician.
Yeah. So John Mulholland was a performing stage magician. He got recruited by CIA to write the handbook on a sleight of hand for CIA, like literally a handbook by a stage magician on how to do close-up stage magic as an agent. Like the manual
Very
of dirty
skill.
Tricks and deception.
Sleight of hand?
Yes.
Incredibly useful.
Yeah, like there's a connection from... CIA is that thing that connects both magic and stage magic.
Well, what is being a spy except for basically being a magician?
Yeah. Yeah, both types.
Literally, though.
Yeah.
I feel like they are very one and the same. There's a lot of similarities between the archetypes.
Oh, yeah. No, there's a weird triangle with, like, stage magicians, sorcerers, and... So, it's we'll say stage magicians, wizards, and fucking spooks. Intelligent and spooks. Yeah. There's a strange triumvirate there.
So John Mulholland is a stage magician hired by the CIA.
Yeah, he's a...
To help teach them about, like...
Deception.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. He was a close ally of Sidney Gottlieb, and he's involved in MKUltra.
Sidney Gottlieb, he's involved with Midnight Climax, right?
Yeah, yeah. That was part of MKUltra. He was the poisoner in chief, is what they referred to Sidney Gottlieb.
He was a chemist, too.
Yeah. He was a weird little elfin fucker.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was a fucking creep, Sidney Gottlieb. He was the head of MKUltra.
Okay.
Yeah. This weird chemist who loved, like, folk dancing and shit. And
Oh, creepy.
Yeah, dude. Yeah, yeah.
No. Irish step dancing is creepy. I know that's not what you said, but I'm just going to put it out
like,
there.
Like, it's close.
Sorry who I insult.
Fair enough.
Dancing with your arms at your sides, looking all blank like that, just staring ahead with your little curly wig all bouncing. What are you doing?
I mean, that's
You're opening up portals.
That's kind of what Sidney Gottlieb was looking like, except, like, I think more on the German side, because there are big Nazi vibes throughout this whole thing. You know? Like, that's not... Let's not forget, this is big Nazi vibes throughout all of this.
Evil vibes in Irish step dancing. That's what I'm going to throw out there.
This is more the German style, I think. No. Don't insult the Irish. They've had a hard go of it.
I know. I'm Irish.
Well, Mulholland despised Puharich for reasons that are still unclear. Well, we do know that like Mulholland wrote a particularly scathing report on Puharich's work and personality. Mulholland accused Puharich of squandering government money on parapsychological experiments that lacked proper controls. He was particularly critical of Puharich's use of a Faraday cage to block electrical interference during psychic tests, and Mulholland suggested that such experiments could yield deceptive results, even downright cheating, by doctors and subjects. But that's standard magician shitting on parapsychology, because stage magicians are... the closest thing to the capital S skeptic.
James Randi. I mean, we're going to encounter him in part two.
Yep. He's part of this.
And he's basically part two's version of Mulholland.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And also another CIA stooge.
Yeah.
But stage magicians kind of see things through the lens of everyone's doing a trick. They don't believe any of it, right?
What's the trick here?
Right. That's just where their head's at.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what you'd expect. But on a trip to the Armor Research Foundation in Chicago, which is a weird organization, if you ever wanted to. Just like, go, huh, I wonder what that is.
Armor Research Foundation.
Yeah.
Chicago. Anything in Chicago's.
Chicago's a creepy fucking city, dude. Mulholland claimed to have caught Puharich in a classic bullshitter's trap. Like when they were talking with, you know, people they were sent there to talk to and shit.
Yeah.
Mulholland kind of suspected Puharich was one of those guys that uses like $4 words to confuse people when he's like needs to get out of something or needs to bullshit. So Mulholland does the thing where he asks Puharich if he was familiar with a certain doctor's work. And Puharich starts rattling off like, oh, yeah, I met him at this time. And he starts rattling off like papers and like his research and stuff. Dude, Mulholland made up that name on the spot. There was no doctor with that name. So he was just like, look, this dude is a bullshitter, you know?
Right.
So there's that. I believe that comes from biography of Mulholland.
God. Yeah. I mean, that tracks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It tracks. Yeah. He's a bullshitter. Puharich is a bullshitter. Like, we...
Well, it's like being out on a date and you're like, oh, have you ever seen the movie like Afternoon of the Sunset? And they're like, yeah, I love that movie. And they're like, you just know that they've never.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm sure I've been guilty of doing that myself. Just unconsciously, I'll be like, oh, yeah, I know that. Like,
yeah,
I know
when I'm not paying attention, I'll do that.
Yeah.
I always think that.
But it's stupid to do that.
It's very stupid to do that.
Because it's always an opportunity to learn more. So why pretend that you know?
Yeah, straight up. I always get scared that, like, when I'm talking with someone and we actually do share, like, tons of the same niche interests and shit, I always think that they're going to think I'm doing that.
No.
That's where my head's
at. I've never been worried about that.
I'm constantly worried about that in every facet of my life. They're going to find out.
They're going to find out what a fraud I am.
There's nothing to find out.
Yeah, no.
Or is there?
What happened to your voice just now?
It's the Batman voice.
Oh, God.
At the very least, Puharich's one of those fellas who uses his giant words to try and confuse people. I hate people like that.
He doesn't want to seem like he knows less than you.
Oh,
he never wants to seem like that.
Ever, yeah. Well, by the mid-1950s, the research at the Roundtable Foundation was going full steam. Puharich had invited the, quote, legendary Dutch psychic Peter Hurkos to America. And the two had become good friends. Peter Hurkos is a piece of work. I heard an interview with him and Puharich like in the 80s or something. Like a phone radio thing he like calls in. He's a bullshitter, dude. And he was described as vulgar and loud, a towering man who was pilloried by people like James Randi. Like Peter Hurkos was like one of the first like going on talk shows psychics. First like celebrities. And he's just this huge Dutchman.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
He was commissioned for helping... like with the high profile cases, like the Sharon Tate murders.
Yes, 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 yes.
Yeah, they like brought him on to do shit like that.
Yep.
Like use your psychic powers to help us.
Yeah, he was like one of the first of those guys.
Family, Boston. Yeah. Okay. Interesting.
He was also arrested and fined $1,000 once for impersonating a federal agent when he disguised himself as a cop to find out information he would later claim was revealed to him through his psychic powers.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Apparently. His psychic abilities were triggered by falling from a ladder?
Could very well be true.
Hey.
I mean, near-death experiences
that
and shit.
That temporal lobe bullshit.
Yeah. Yeah.
That frontal lobe trauma. It'll do something.
Also involved in the research were Eileen Garrett and author and mystic Harry Stone. Puharich's book, Beyond Telepathy, goes into great detail on the psychic research they conducted there. We can talk about it a little bit, but like it is worth reading if you're interested in this stuff, because it isn't like Puharich is a bullshitter. But I also do think that a lot of his research was legitimate.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think Beyond Telepathy is a lie of a book. I think it's an actual book.
Right. Like, it wasn't made to be a fake, like, haha, gotcha thing. We're just going to make money off of this. It was made with an honest effort to do something, whether or not it amounted to anything real or not. It was made with an honest effort to try and...
I think Puharich was legitimately interested in psychic powers.
Correct, yeah.
And I think a lot of his bullshitting was in order to facilitate that, facilitate the actual research. He wasn't trying to con people out of money. Right, I think the book is part of the actual research. I mean, just the detail he goes into, the notes, the footnotes, the references, the sources, all this shit, it's very good.
Mm-hmm. It's him trying to legitimize his life's work.
I mean, it's the book that comes out of the Roundtable Foundation on psychic phenomena. It's sick. I recommend it. But one of the super interesting things that Puharich documents in that book was the connection between the parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system on the ability to psychically receive and send information, respectively. Now, We talked about this extensively in our Benadryl episode because of what that drug does. The sympathetic nervous system is your active fight or flight response nervous system, or fight or flight or freeze or whatever. It's that engaged, like fucking cold sweats, shit's happening nervous system, right? Your parasympathetic is your rest and digest nervous system. That's your kicking back, receiving, letting things flow in, a meditative state, alpha brainwave, shit like that.
Yeah.
So this was...
rest and digest.
Yeah. So Puharich discovers that there's a serious connection between sending messages in a sympathetic activated state, an adrenergic state, adrenaline running, versus receiving information in a parasympathetic or cholinergic state, which is interesting considering all the drug research he was doing, or a muscarinic state also. Yeah. So, and this was discovered, and I have to include this because what would the nonsense bizarre be without getting a little bit of scatological humor, throw it in there, just on the top, right? Eileen Garrett reported feeling fatigued and having very wet poops after an extended psychic session, a classic marker for an activated parasympathetic nervous system.
Well, her bowels are real loose.
This book is sick.
Loosey.
As an example of how the sympathetic fight or flight nervous system contributes to the sending of telepathic signals, Puharich recounts a story of a construction worker working in Boston who had just finished up for the day and was having a snack. Parasympathy. Sitting back, having a snack. And all of a sudden, he feels the need to go to this other construction site a few blocks away because he just knows someone's in danger. The thing is, no one was supposed to be working there that day. They weren't scheduled to be there that day. There should have been no one at that site. But he feels all of a sudden, oh shit, someone's in danger over by the zoo.
Yeah.
Right? He tells people around, I've got this bad feeling. Like, dude, no one's there. What are you talking about? Well, he's like, I got to go. So he runs over there. And what he finds is that a dude had been over there, one of the dudes on his crew, and he had fallen into a hole and had his legs trapped and could not get out. And he definitely would have died if homeboy hadn't found him.
Jesus.
Yeah.
So it's almost as if like, see, I imagine in the context of what we're talking about, that being in this parasympathetic state, this resting state, this open state, if you will, it gives your mind enough open space in order to receive those signals from perhaps other people or from around you.
And especially if they're in a sympathetic state where this dude fell into a hole and he was going to die.
Right.
And so it like focuses his shit into this like beam.
Yeah. So it like his chaotic vortex of like, I'm going to die energy found its way to the nearest void.
Yeah. Yeah.
The nearest accessible void to someone who was connected within his mind matrix, somebody who knew him.
Yeah.
And when they were in that state of emptiness, if you will, like that state of rest, it enabled that point of action to reach them.
Yes.
And for him to realize, oh shit, I actually can't rest.
Yeah.
Need to go do something.
That's
not sure what. Need to go do it.
Yeah, that's basically...
signal received. Must go do.
Yeah, that's basically what Puharich writes.
Yeah.
And he does like talk about the matrix network thing too. Like that's part of it. But also you can have people that act as bridges between networks.
Oh, yeah.
Like that's also a thing.
Am I insane because this makes sense to me?
I mean, this is what a scientist wrote about parapsychology. So like...
yeah.
It's probably the least insane thing in an insane field to like think makes sense. Like it's a very good book, you know. I have to give him props for this.
Yeah,
that's also he writes is like why like you'll see a mom realizing her kids are in danger like while she's having a cup of tea, shit like that. Like at this, you know, the 4 p.m. period of the day, right? Sitting at the kitchen table, and all of a sudden gets the feeling that her kid's in danger. Kid's in a sympathetic activated state. She's in a parasympathetic state. They have the link, and like this pattern kind of happens over and over again. But there's a ton of other interesting shit in that book, too. Like, another example is Harry Stone, the author and mystic, had a trick where he could do where you could have him in a room with, like, 10 to 12 people, and he'd say, all right, I'm going to leave this room for 5 minutes. Does anyone have a dime in their pocket? And someone would say, yeah, I got a dime. He's like, okay, I'm going to leave this room for 5 minutes, and you hide that dime, and I'll find it when I get back. And he'd go out, they'd hide the dime, he'd come back in blindfolded, and immediately walk to the place the dime is. Right? But one time, they noticed that the person who hid the dime waffled on where to hide it, like, 5 times, like, second-guessing and moving it and going,
oh, maybe I'll put it here. Oh, no.
Yeah. And when Harry Stone came back in, blindfolded, Puharich saw that he traced the dime hider's steps perfectly. He went to all the spots that the dude almost hit it in the right order.
Yeah.
So Puharich got to think that this was telepathic rather than, like, dimeopathic. Like that Harry Stone was not focusing on the dime. He was focusing on the person.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where he was getting the information. So they tried a new experiment wherein the person hiding the dime would when Harry Stone came back into the room, concentrate on an area where the dime was not. Say if it's hidden, you know, under the coffee cup, you think about the windowsill, something like that. And sure enough, this made Harry Stone go to the wrong place, the place where the person was concentrating on, rather than where the dime was actually hidden.
Fascinating.
Fascinating.
So he knows who the person is placing the dime?
Yeah.
Well, I imagine if you're highly attuned to other people and their body language, you're paying very close attention to that person who placed the dime, their eye movements, their head movements.
Before.
Yeah.
Before you leave the room.
Even before you leave the room. What's near to them? What are they looking at? Oh, dude,
good call.
You know? Yeah. And when you enter the room, what do they first look at? What does their head move towards?
Well, he's blindfolded when he goes back in.
Oh, well, that's fascinating.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah.
But beforehand, I mean, well, no, he might see that, like, their eyes might dart to the place they're going to hide it immediately, but not every time.
Right.
Not every person's going to do that.
And there's probably, honestly, limited places where you could hide a dime. There's probably a few good places between a couch cushion, perhaps, but most people probably...
Well, here's the thing. If you're blindfolded, it's also impressive to just walk straight to the...
It is.
A place.
No, it certainly is. But I'm trying to think of what are ways that you could try...
To falsify it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, how could you try to figure out where someone had placed something and follow their eyes, follow their head? Where do they look?
I mean, I think... Well, the thing that doesn't explain
that's not
the
credit anything.
That doesn't explain the waffling on a place five times and second guessing.
Not at all.
You know, but that's a good thing to keep in mind, though. Like, there are more complex ways to tell certain things than you might initially think.
Yeah, and they could just be as simple as observational skills that a lot of people maybe don't pay attention to.
True. Then he also talks about the old Indian rope trick, where it looked like a magician and his assistant would send a rope and disappear into nothing from, like, having it coiled on the ground, like, lifted up, climb a rope in the air and go into nothing. But upon reviewing videotapes of it, what happened, they didn't actually, there was no illusion really going on. They just stepped away from the rope and stood as part of the crowd. But if you were there, it looked like they disappeared into nothingness, but they actually just stood still for a second. And he attributes this to some sort of, like, telepathic glamour, which would be very fucking interesting. Or the CIA would be very interested in that, you know. Now, remember, even if you don't believe this, this motherfucker worked for people that run our goddamn country. Should I choose to believe this because it's less frightening if it's actually real, you know? But also, Park is a bullshitter. So Harry Stone, we didn't mention this in the episode on the nine, but in 1954, while testing his psychometry with Alice Bouverie, that's object reading, getting information from an object, Alice Bouverie had a gold pendant that allegedly belonged to the ancient Egyptian queen Tia, mother of Akhenaten.
Okay.
Yeah. Which, being a rich bitch, she probably did. Who knows? If anyone did, she did, you know? After apparently having a seizure, Stone went into a deep trance and began to utter words in strange language. Then he drew a series of hieroglyphs before talking in English about a drug that would stimulate psychic abilities. He spoke, among other things, about entering an underground hall where a statue of a dog-headed man came to life and shit.
Good Lord.
So Bouverie was super excited by this, and she immediately, like, called Puharich at the army base for advice on what to do next. She, like, mailed him drawings and a copy of Stone's strange utterances. Puharich took them to, he says, another army doctor on the site, who just so happened to be an expert in extremely rare and archaic forms of hieroglyphs. And to his... great surprise, verified that Stone's writings were indeed ancient Egyptian. The communicator had identified himself as Rahotep, naming his wife as Nefert.
Wow, okay.
This is before the Nine identify themselves as the Egyptian gods, by the way. That happens later.
Mm-hmm.
So many of the details that Rahotep communicated to Stone were in fact confirmed by Puharich and this anonymous army doctor. Just happened to be an amateur expert Egyptologist.
Right, because of course.
Specializing in ancient and archaic hieroglyphs.
Ancient and archaic, yeah. Wow, just around the board.
So, you know, all these details that Stone had, you know, that were confirmed by these guys, they were, what's the term? Bullshit. They were bullshit. They were bad it was bad Egyptology.
Yeah.
It was just wrong. Just straight up fucking wrong. About what the pyramids were used for and what was where and all this shit. But it was definitely shit that amateur expert Egyptologists at the time would have thought was right. Like Puharich and the anonymous army doctor who's probably just Puharich.
Oh, you know, yeah.
Yeah. The most important aspect of these communications was that Rahotep's main concern was to import in, impart information about a drug used by the priests of Heliopolis to open the door to the gods, a mushroom that induced hallucinatory experiences, a sort of chemical stargate. From Stone's drawings, Buharic identified the Amanita muscaria mushroom.
Alright.
This is not the psilocybin mushroom, although he would become interested in that as well. But the Amanita muscaria, the toadstool, has a long history of use as a shamanic tool. Santa Claus is probably...
I mean, that's like the fly agaric. That's the red cap with the white spots. That's the classic Alice in Wonderland cartoon mushroom. Yeah. That is the Amanita muscaria.
It is not a psilocybin mushroom. It has no chemical relation to LSD or DMT or psilocybin.
It's really poisonous.
Most of the super poisonous mushrooms are all Amanitas.
Yeah.
The death angel and shit. Well, what the toadstool is, what the Amanita muscaria is, muscaria, as in muscarinic, it's a deliriant and a powerful cholinergic.
Mm-hmm.
Just like the Datura extracts they were using at Edgewood. Just like Buharic's research on cholinergic states, the parasympathetic nervous system. Just like that E164 bullshit you were talking about earlier, the five-day fuck-you-up.
Yep.
Yeah.
The five-day fuck-you-up.
Well, that's an anticholinergic, but it's another drug that acts on the cholinergic nervous system, which seems, over the course of years, to be Buharic's main chemical focus.
Yep.
The cholinergic system, right?
Yes, because the muscarinic receptors in your body, which are a type of receptor protein found in the central and peripheral nervous systems, are activated by this neurotransmitter that is found, should be, you know, found in abundance, should be found in its normal amount, acetylcholine.
Yes.
That's what that is.
That's the thing.
That's the neurotransmitter that will either completely fuck you up or...
That's the neurotransmitter that I forgot the name of while I was writing this.
Acetylcholine.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, Amanita muscaria does both things. It cholinergizes and then anticholinergizes.
Yeah.
Because Buharic wrote that it enhances psychic powers up until the hallucinations start, then it doesn't. Now, this is real funny because, like, he learned about the Amanita muscaria, the secret ancient Egyptian stargate drug, from a hieroglyph that Harry Stone wrote while talking to this Egyptian fucking entity named Rahotep that, like, probably did exist, but, like, not, they got a bunch of details wrong and shit. Like, here's the goddamn fucking thing. We already knew a few things, you know, from the writings of Buharic and others, and curiously enough, from our episodes on Benadryl, and we know all sorts of fun shit about cholinergics and anticholinergics. One has said the cholinergic system was one of the primary things that the ghouls at Edgewood were looking into. Two, Buharic found the link to the parasympathetic nervous system, in his own words, from a lady's wet poops. So his ass already knew the connection between muscarine and telepathy, or at least trance states. And Edgewood Arsenal was working on the exact same bullshit for chemical weapons.
Right, because this acetylcholine, this neurotransmitter, it affects literally everything in your body.
Yeah.
Like, it is the main chemical messenger. It affects muscle movement. It affects memory and learning. It affects attention. It affects your automatic nervous system, which includes stuff like your heart rate.
Yeah.
Your digestion.
Yeah.
Your glands. How you process pain.
Yep.
It is the neurotransmitter that controls all of this stuff. So if you can fuck with someone on this level and fuck with this neurotransmitter, then basically it's like, right, you know, it's like in our parasite pill episode, this idea of how a human can be like infected to act differently than they normally would. Well, get them at their cholinergic system.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It'll fuck everything up.
Yeah.
Fuck their neurotransmitters up.
That's absolutely there's a logical reason to see that Buharic might have thought maybe acetylcholine has something to do with dynamics.
Oh, totally.
Because it's the thing that transmits the information all over the body.
Right. And when people are in that delirious state, they experience intense hallucinations. They meet with dead family members. They have incredible trance-like, dreamlike experiences.
So that brings us to three. This is less of a thing we know than something we can infer. It is far more likely that Buharic started looking at the Amanita muscaria mushroom because of these factors than it is because a channeled ancient Egyptian entity that didn't actually know shit about Egypt told him about it. Andrija Puharich is a greasy, greasy fucking bastard. Like, some big lies in there.
Yeah.
Some big old fucking lies. In 1956, he and Peter Herkos and Arthur Young went down to Mexico looking for shrooms on the dime of probably CIA, allegedly. This is when he was contacted by The Logheads, which you'll remember from the 9 episode.
Go over who they are again, just real quick.
So the Logheads, we didn't know at the time, were actually the subject of the book When Prophecy Fails. They were connected to George Hunt Williamson, who is connected to goddamn William Dudley Pelley, the Nazi. So, in fact, I've heard, the Logheads found Puharich and Herkos and Young at this expat fucking cafe down in southern Mexico. And they said, hey, this medium told us to come to Mexico because we got this message from this thing calling itself the Nine, and you should pay attention.
How the fuck did they know?
Well, they had a medium. And in fact, I've heard that it was George Hunt Williamson who is the mysterious medium.
Okay.
Well, later Puharich would learn that it was Spectra, the alien spacecraft that was telling Uri Geller he was Jesus.
Get into that in part two.
That's next week. We've only just begun. We sent the Logheads. It could have been George Hunt Williamson who sent the Logheads down to Mexico looking for Andrea in the first place.
Jesus Christ, it's all just such a tangled web.
Oh, yeah. It's been speculated that Puharich was sent on that Mexico trip by CIA as part of Project Artichoke, which would make sense. If there was, as I said, a chemical compound that could induce specifically the receiving of telepathic signals and controlled all of your fucking body, well, boy, howdy, that sure'd be something. Hit him with the muscarine and then have some weird CIA psychic beaming instructions into him. Or I don't know, like maybe a machine, maybe. Who knows?
Or just a guy sitting there saying stuff.
Yeah, or a machine, maybe, because it's important to consider that Andrija Puharich was a scientist. You know, and he, in his own words, believed that there wasn't any supernatural element to this stuff. Just an undiscovered force, right? As we go further in this series, I do wonder if that will change. But here's the other fucking thing Puharich is known for.
Yes.
Medical implants.
Yeah.
He contributed to early research that would become the cochlear hearing aid. It's often reported that he was one of the inventors of that. He's not. At least he's not on the patent for that, but he's on a patent for earlier technology that would become that, which is hearing aids and shit that stimulate the actual nerves rather than amplifying sound or something, getting around your eardrums in general, literally wiring shit into your fucking head, right?
Yeah.
Those are the patents that Andrija Puharich produced. Patents to wire shit into your facial nerves to let you hear, that is to say, transmit voices directly to your skull through electronic means. That's what his patents are for. It's what they're on.
Voice to skull technology.
Like, look at Google Patents. That's where his fucking name is. It's on that shit, right?
Mm.
No, but it's to help the people hear, and he's just like Jesus did, you know? Cure the fucking deaf. He also made this tooth filling that was a radio receiver. A radio receiver implanted in a tooth filling that would use the dental structure to transmit voices into your skull. Isn't it kind of fucking strange how many people around Andrija Puharich channeled a weird mechanical sounding voice that seemed to come from somewhere other than their vocal cords?
Yeah.
Jesus fucking Christ. Like, that's a thing that just shows up around him, this entire thing.
Definitely can't be understated.
Yeah. Like, literally, there are so many. It keeps happening. You will see with Uri Geller. You see with fucking Dr. Vinod. Like, he hypnotizes a motherfucker, and then they start talking with this voice that seems to come from somewhere else that's weird and metallic. Now, he'll end up saying that it gets recorded onto tapes and stuff, but then the tapes mysteriously disappear and all this shit.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't know this for sure. Like, let me be very clear. Like, we don't have proof of this. But the sort of hardcore, the falsification of Puharich's bullshit ends somewhere so fucking dark, it's really frightening. Like,
yeah.
And if you are going to be a, like, how could all this shit have happened? Like, where's the trick? Where's the magic trick? Where that goes is, like, so fucking dark that, like, yikes. This man said he wanted to design a mind. This is fucking scary shit, dude. Anyway, we'll get back to that. Also, I don't know where and when he learned hypnosis, but he was an extremely competent hypnotist.
Pretty easy to do.
Throughout the 1960s, it was those implants that he worked on with the company Intellectron. The Roundtable Foundation shut down in like 1959, just ran out of money and shit. Times were changing. They did their stuff. Also in the 1960s, the other thing he was working on was the Brazilian psychic surgeon Arrigo. Arrigo was a Brazilian dude who claimed, and so did many, many, many others, to be able to use psychic powers to perform healing on people. This motherfucker, apparently, according to Puharich, so, you know, he'd have people lined up for a mile to have him heal them.
And just for the record, I don't buy it for 1 second.
Fair enough. And he wasn't just laying on hands either. Nah, this dude would take a rusty knife, a dirty knife, never cleaned, a meat cleaver, in fact, slice people open, take out their tumors or infections or whatever, zip them up and send them on their way. No anesthetic or nothing. But this dude treated over 300 patients a day for 20 years, apparently. The president of Brazil brought his damn daughter to him. Puharich brought back a bunch of 8mm film. It's silent, so it doesn't play well for radio, but you can watch it on YouTube. And this dude sticks a rusty-ass meat cleaver into people's eyes and wiggles it around, and you can see the blade under the skin.
Mm-hmm.
It's really weird. Like, it's weird. Like, I know it should be bullshit, and I can see how it would be bullshit, but actually seeing it is fucking odd. Like, there's odd shit to Origo. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's odd. It's one of the weirdest fucking things I've ever heard of or seen. And apparently it wasn't actually Origo doing this. It was a channeled entity. A Prussian German feller.
Okay, so it's this Brazilian dude named Origo, but the thing that's doing all of these healings,
yeah,
it's not him. It's this entity.
It's a German named Dr. Fritz.
Good Prussian. Lord.
In South America in the post-World War II era, you know, it's just kind of a funny thing to have going on.
I was possessed by a Nazi.
And when he would do this, it was actually Dr. Fritz talking with like a whole ass German accent and shit. Like, his voice changed and shit. I don't even know. In an interview in 1987, Puharich said this.
When you're there watching him operate, you can't believe it's real. It shocks every sensibility. Guy walks up to him and Origo says, "You've got a cancer near the pancreas. Pull up your shirt, drop your pants." Pulls out a knife, opens it up, cuts open the intestine and glues the two ends together, and somehow, just like that, the person is healed. There'd be a couple hundred people lined up around his house waiting to be next. The average treatment was about 2 minutes, and all of this was done without anesthesia or antisepsis.
Allegedly.
Allegedly.
Puharich is a medical doctor, also a fucking liar. Why would he lie about Origo, though? That's weird. Things don't add up, is all I'm saying. Shit's odd. This Origo motherfucker, also, despite having a third grade education, would diagnose and write out modern prescriptions and not have any memory of it. That's the story. Critics would say that they were really simple prescriptions and some of them were wrong and shit. There's a very long clip of Puharich talking about Origo, but we're running so long that I just don't think I'm going to play it.
Yeah.
But Puharich became really good friends with Origo. I mean, okay, here's the weird thing about Origo, right? He was imprisoned for practicing chicanery.
Yeah.
But they let him keep practicing psychic medicine while he was imprisoned because the entire country believed it. Like, the church believed it enough to let him keep practicing in prison. The government believed it enough to let him keep practicing in prison and shit. Like, that's weird.
Right.
Also, Puharich saw a bunch of UFOs in Brazil when he was there. He would go there, like, regularly from 1961 to 1968. That was his big project. He thought that Origo was his guy, his new Jesus, right? It's odd. I don't know. It's odd.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Puharich does also say that he was down there initially working as a consultant for NASA for some fucking reason. Because fuck it, why not? He's a ghost. It's so weird, dude. I don't know. Well, yeah. Puharich made trip after trip down to Brazil between 1961 and 1968. And then in 1971, Origo died in a car accident.
Okay.
He just fucking died.
As people do.
Yeah. Puharich writes that he was heartbroken about this for like a while.
Okay.
Yeah, he knew. I mean, and he was also like, he thought that this was his ticket.
Origo was like the real deal. The real deal.
This is the one.
Okay.
Yeah. And like he would, you know, later when he was talking to the intelligence spectra or the group of intelligence, which is also just the nine again, through Uri Geller, yeah, he would end up talking to like the spirit of Origo, and he would come to believe that it was one intelligence that was responsible for all of the paranormal bullshit, right?
Oh, I love
it. Yeah. Yeah.
I can't wait.
Also, in the 1960s, Puharich traveled to Hawaii and was initiated into the religion of the goddess Pele.
Pele, bitch.
Yeah, dude.
Carlson, love has won.
Yes, yes. I found an article written by the son of the Hawaiian shaman who did this with Puharich. This dude was like a kid at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And he talks about how fucking Puharich, you know, gets there and like, you know, it's kind of a taboo thing, but like, his dad agrees to do it, and so he goes into a trance and he fucking calls to the heavens to Pele. And like weird shit starts happening. And Puharich's like, okay, ask it so-and-so. And the shaman goes like, well, you're standing right there. Like, you ask her. And so Puharich like starts demanding answers from a god, and like weird sounds start coming from the sky and shit. And just like all, it just starts going like Puharich's a fucking magician on a volcano talking to a goddamn volcano god, is the way the son of the shaman describes it in an article I found on archive.org. That's just some random ass thing on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
So that's weird too.
Yup.
Yup. Like, the bullshit is off the chain. And the really weird shit is off the chain. Both.
Yup.
But no one knows about this dude.
Yeah.
It's so fucking weird. And in 1971, the boy would get up to even more and weirder stuff when he met a young Israeli psychic named Uri Geller.
Possible, potential, very likely spook.
Definitely spook. 100%.
Without a doubt, actually.
I mean, he says he worked for Mossad, so like at the very least, he was Mossad.
Pretty much, you know? Confirmed.
Yeah, he's Mossad.
And future president of the United States.
You do have to be born in the U.S.
Well, I trust him to be the first non-U.S. born president.
I mean, there's time travel shit with Uri Geller, too, so like, who knows?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uri Geller is Abraham Lincoln.
And...
Sorry, Uri Geller.
I thought you were going to say Abraham.
Abraham Lincoln.
Abraham.
Abraham.
Yeah, and in this next couple year period, Puharich would end up meeting the intelligence called Spectra, and a lot of really weird shit would happen in Israel. And that's what we're going to focus on next week. We're going to zero in on the book Puharich wrote about his time with Uri Geller. It legitimately only gets fucking weirder from here. I know it's a lot, guys. I'm in for this. Yeah.
Even if they aren't. I'm strapped in for all three parts, and you guys better come along with us.
This shit is crazy. It's just fucking insane.
So.
The Six of Discs.
It is so interesting in relation to this, because it's all about power, resources, knowledge, the idea of giving and receiving. Who's on which end?
Yes.
You know?
Oh my God, you're so... Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's all... Because also six is in the middle of...
It's Tiferet. You know, it's the fucking... It's the Christ-centered...
Right. Yeah. Because every suit of cards goes 1 through 10. So six is kind of your past five, which is really the point of chaos, the point of crisis. You're past the midpoint. And now you're kind of at a turning point, but you are still like... At this midpoint of, you know, which one are you?
On the Tree of Life, six is right in the center on the middle pillar.
Yeah.
It is the point of balance on the Tree
like
of Life.
In this card, when you pull it, it's really like, well, which one are you? Are you the beggar or are you the giver?
Well, we're both the same.
Yeah.
It's the acknowledgement that we are both throughout our lives, you know? So that's why you pay it forward, right?
And there's this constant interplay throughout our lives, which is very evident in... Puharich's story.
I think so. And I think especially as we start to see how things start going crazier and crazier for Puharich,
mm-hmm.
and it starts to seem like perhaps he is the one being fucked with.
Right. Because he's, you know, he's always finding himself on this side or that side, but never really sure which one.
I mean, I think he thinks that through.
Or at least that's how I feel as a spectator looking in on his life. I'm not sure.
I think that he is a very arrogant man and a very quietly arrogant man. Well, yeah, and I think that, like, Puharich spent a lot of his early career just, like, schmoozing. I mean, the whole thing with John Mulholland at the Armour Research Foundation, I mean, he's angling for a benefactor. He wants a wealthy patron, you know?
Yep.
I sort of half think that that's the reason for the George Washington essay. Like, he knew it would work. Like, I honestly am starting to think that that might be the real reason. Because he knew that's what wins contests.
Yep.
You know? At the same time, there's enough weird shit that happens around. Even just finding the writing from the fucking Hawaiian shaman fucking son.
Right.
Just some random thing on the internet somewhere that I have to go on archive.org to get and shit.
Do you think that it was important for Puharich to be important? Like,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. He thought he was very, very smart. And he
and
was.
That
he was right
mattered
about it too.
To him to have a legacy.
Yeah. I mean, I think that, you know, if you want to get back into the astrology shit again, my having so many of the same placements but then like oriented different
and
makes me think of like the connection between like
George Washington, how he writes of George Washington as like an alien, a man who cannot be appreciated by the people of his time.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like that's very much how he wishes to be remembered.
I think so, and I think
he
was
maybe people don't get me now, They will.
But I think he was also very focused on this deification, an idolization of knowledge and learning and
absolutely
knowledge for knowledge's sake.
Yeah.
Which I can't get down with, I don't think. Right. I think there's a lot of empathy missing from even the way Puharich talks about his friends and shit.
Right. Because it was like, what was his
pursuit
nice. Of all of this knowledge? Did he use it to build relationships?
Did the world get better for his presence?
And friends? Like, who were the people that actually mattered to him? And like, I mean, he has his fun little buddy comedy with Uri Geller that we'll get into next week.
He's got Peter Herkos.
But ultimately, like, his friends were other assholes. Like, Ira Einhorn,
right.
Peter Herkos, Uri Geller. These are all fucking asshole womanizers. Hey, I mean,
don't talk shit about Uri Geller.
No, but really, you can imagine
that. I fucking love Uri Geller.
He's definitely a womanizer, though.
He's a loyal man.
No. No, that man's a dog.
Are you sure? I don't know. He's a sensitive fella. We can't slander Uri Geller. He will sue us.
They're all dogs. They were in the dog club together. And I mean, God bless him for it. But no, like,
I think Uri's a sensitive soul. Mm-mm. Uri's different than these other. He didn't trust Puharich.
Yeah.
I don't know who Uri Geller is. And I can't talk too much shit about him because he will sue us. That's just true.
It's okay. I'll give him a rim job. It'll smooth us over.
Well, we do have a lawyer on retainer. That's
yeah.
But yeah, and I think that this the cycle of being the benefactor, being the one who benefits, being the one who gets the benefit. I think in the reverse form, like the manipulative aspect of being a beneficiary is that like he ends up getting maybe fucked with, like maybe the shit that starts happening in Israel.
Right,
he believes, I don't know.
Eileen Garrett, right, founder of the Parapsychological Foundation, she's really interested in all this shit. He, too, has a cursory interest in it. He's very fascinated by all of these things, too. But the people who are funding him, the people who are around him, also have these interests, and I imagine are helping to guide along his interests and his version of thinking of these things.
Yeah, I wonder.
They're the ones funding his research.
Yeah, and I wonder, like, at a certain point, maybe, like, how much is he just, like, being the guy?
Right.
You know, like that does have to be fun being the guy.
Oh, totally.
But also, he could buy the George Washington bullshit, too, and think that's his duty to, like, shape America, and which is, like, shades of Nazism, right? Like,
oh, yeah.
This whole, like, not, you know, the esoteric Nazi philosophy, the Nazism as a philosophy from the fucking future.
Right.
That dark shit, like that mind control, Alan Dulles. Like, we have to perfectly control society type shit.
Yeah, and it's also interesting tying this back into astrology with the lack of Earth in his chart and this sort of ever-present...
Hyper Aquarius as well.
Yeah, and his search for legacy. Like, this idea of how do I ground myself to this Earth? I have to do it through my scientific research, through my search of information, through my legacy.
I don't know if he ever cared about that. He certainly seems very ephemeral when he talks as an old man.
Right, but I also think he cares about legacy as his grounding quality, as his, like, that earthly element that he's missing in his life that he wishes to attain.
Or he might have just been super curious. He might have just been the curious cat, you know? Totally amoral. Prince of Cups.
I wish we knew more about his childhood and adolescence and young adulthood to form our idea of him more, but we'll just have to go off of what we know.
Yeah, I mean, there's shit I haven't read, but, like, there's the book Memories of a Maverick, written by one of his ex-wives, that Uri Geller hosts on his website. That's
maybe that's a future episode.
Well, it's one of the big sources I'm using.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, it's written very positively.
Yeah.
Like, Memories of a Maverick. But there's not, like, I use most of the beats.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a lot that changes.
I don't get a whole lot of insight into him as, like, I don't feel like I know him as an individual.
Despite one of the source is supposedly being this super personal thing.
Yeah.
I don't know. Despite using his books and his, I don't know.
Yeah.
It's weird, right? Like, it's hard to describe.
12th house Aries, or not Aries, Aquarius dominant.
Yeah.
He doesn't really want to be known.
It's fucking creepy.
He wants to be remembered, but he doesn't want to be known.
There you go. Or maybe I'm just totally wrong. Maybe he's a great dude. And I know he fucking wasn't. I have to take a stand on this. This is ridiculous. He was a bastard. He was a greasy fucking bastard.
Greasy bastard.
All right.
Well, we'll see you next week.
Yeah, next week we're having a fucking fun psychic times in Israel.
Yes.
Hell yes. If you like what we do and you want to support the show, if you want to hear some our bonus stuff, we're going to be talking about the Book of Jean, the secret esoteric text that Theosophy is based off of, but it's actually not really. It's just some fucking whack-ass poems made up by a Russian lady.
Yep.
That's what we're talking about this week on our bonus series, The Corkboard Bazaar. You can get access to that for as low as $5 a month at patreon.com/thenonsensebazaar.
Also get access to our Discord, yes, where we're chilling. We're big chilling.
I haven't been in there a lot lately because...
I'm getting
Well, we had 5 hours of recording that shit the bed. That is a thing that happened.
We already recorded this.
Already did this.
So please.
Yeah, it's a lot of sacrifice.
Our efforts.
Yeah, I'm going to play us out on a fucking, on a stupid track I whipped together with samples from one of Puharich's TV appearances and also early gear. Yeah. I call this Puharich Wave.
We're in Mexico, thousands of miles from our Hollywood sound stages, in a place called Mita, on the very edge of civilization. There are no actors, there's no script. For this psychic report can only be recorded at the moment it happens. Our chartered plane will fly us to a remote mountain village to look for, of all things, a mushroom. A very strange mushroom indeed, with powers beyond belief. And last, our forever optimistic, Dr. Andrija Puharich. Dr. Puharich has brought us here in the first place.
The pilot says he'll be ready soon, John.
It's breaking, I think, now.
On the very edge of civilization.
Incredible is the word.
It's breaking, I think, now. It's
very spooky.
Look, it's becoming plastic. And there is no heat.
If anybody tries to get in here, I'll hit him on the head.
Seems to have an incredible effect on the power of extrasensory perception.
Incredible is the word. We're here for some very specific purposes. I would say that our prime mission is to explore and examine these new mushrooms and find out if they can be of any benefit in this problem of mental disease.
It's breaking, I think, now.
On the very edge of civilization.
Incredible is the word.
It's breaking, I think, now. It's
very spooky.
Look, it's becoming plastic. And there is no heat.
If anybody tries to get in here, I'll hit him on the head.
It's breaking, I think, now.
On the very edge of civilization.
Incredible is the word.
It's breaking, I think, now. It's
very spooky.
Look, it's becoming plastic. And there is no heat.
If anybody tries to get in here, I'll hit him on the head.